Good afternoon. Welcome to the third Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture for this year. This afternoon, Rhea Edge, Professor of Art and Chair of Fine and Performing Arts, will discuss her travels and the influence of nature on her creative work. Before I say more about Professor Edge, though, I want to recognize a very important guest in our audience today. This series is named for Dr. Clarence R. Noe, Eureka College class of 1938, who served as dean of the college. With us again today is his widow, Mrs. Charlotte Noe, who has been a loyal supporter of this series and of Eureka College. Mrs. Noe, we thank you for your continuing commitment to Eureka College. Professor Rhea Edge has been a passionate teacher of art at Eureka College for almost 20 years, and her talent as a teacher and mentor were recognized when she received the Helen Cleaver Distinguished Teaching Award in 2004. During her years at Eureka, she has helped hundreds of students with varying levels of artistic skill and experience to express themselves through art using a variety of media. She has integrated student art into the fabric of the college community. Whether by hanging student artwork in Burgess, in my office, and across campus, or helping students exhibit their work in Burgess Gallery or Moser Lobby, Professor Edge has continually helped students see that their artistic expression is valued by our community. Professor Edge is a working artist with an impressive portfolio of work. I had the privilege to visit her studio two summers ago and was struck by the quality of the work. But maybe more than that, I was struck by the way that she described her creative process, and I suspect that's something we'll all hear about today. For many years, Professor Edge's talent has been recognized by her colleagues. She was awarded a prestigious year-long Max Beckman Fellowship to the Brooklyn Museum Art School. She's won numerous awards for her work, and recently received a College of Fine Arts Alumni Award from Illinois State University, where she completed her MFA. She's also an active member of the Bloomington community and currently serves as president of the John Wesley Powell Chapter of the National Audubon Society. Professor Edge is an outstanding colleague whose intellectual curiosity beyond her discipline is seemingly boundless. Please join me in welcoming Professor Rhea Edge.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cavalier, and thank you all. You honor me being here today. And imagine, it's 46 degrees out. Only 56 degrees in Eureka, California. So we're almost there. It's a fabulous day, and I appreciate so much your taking your time to come out and visit with me this afternoon. Thank you, Charlotte, and thank you, faculty, students, staff, and special guests. The three capybara that you see on the screen were just about to dive into the water as I took this picture. Positioned on the beach in Brazil, gigantic rodent-like creatures, very special mammals from one of my trips. I was attempting to stand on the car seat with the top half of my body out the moonroof when a friendly but curious police officer peered in the window. Inside, he found three pair of binoculars pointed toward the observation towers at the airport. Were they possible terrorists? No, birders. Within the first 10 days of January, Dale, Les, and I had seen 19 winged beings and were well on our way to a record-seeking 2 birds per day. Somewhere in front of that airstrip was a snowy owl. Mark Obamasik's birding story, The Big Year, a tale of man, nature, and fowl obsession, illustrates the life of competitive bird listers as they fly from home and family at an instant's notice in pursuit of an elusive winged reward. In the film by the same name, we see actors Steve Martin, Jack Black, and Owen Wilson in humorous competition as they travel from coast to coast at the drop of a rare bird alert or a text message proclaiming the opportunity for sighting a Bahama mockingbird, a rare Kirkland's warbler, or a pink-footed goose. This is the rare Kirkland's warbler. To put this into perspective, about 850 bird species have been recorded in all of North America. And seeing 300 of them can qualify you as a serious birder. Those boasting over 600 species are considered to be a part of an elite group, with the current big year record being 745 species seen in 1 year. And yes, it was set in 1998 by Sandy Comito, the actual winner in the book. Here's the book, The Big Year. A lifetime of travel and deliberate searching can produce what is to bird watchers the holy grail of bird lists. Notably, a count that competes with the best birders in the world. The quest to see over 10,000 birds is like any other extreme sport in that it requires commitment, drive, and self-sacrifice, in addition to time, money, and complete preoccupation. In 2009, Olivia Gentile, a Harvard and 2003 MFA nonfiction writing Columbia graduate, wrote Life List. This book follows the true story of Phoebe Snetzinger, a St. Louis housewife and cancer survivor who sacrificed home and hearth to travel the world and to set the record for seeing 84.8% of around 10,000 documented bird species. The quest to paint and publish images of all birds in North America was an equivalent obsession for the artist naturalist John James Audubon. He was guided and in competition with early ornithological work by the poet naturalist Alexander Wilson. Forever recorded in history, the Birds of America, which with its 435 hand-colored life-size prints of 497 bird species, is considered one of the most excellent ornithological works ever completed. Audubon gained notoriety as an artist by adding expression and pictorial space to the diagrammatic approach of earlier bird illustrators, making each page a fusion of art and science. And of interest to students, Audubon had explored both bird watching and drawing since childhood. And after several unsuccessful careers, he committed himself to art and ornithology at the age of 26. Making lists of birds and sketches of wildlife for paintings is a tangible, immediate process. One can apply what artists refer to as direct observation to both. An owl sought, found, and examined can be checked off the birder's list, can be recorded in a drawing, or can be photographed. But how does the image become a work of art? What does the artist do to communicate greater truth? As the renowned 19th century French Impressionist Edgar Degas said,
"Drawing is not what you see, but what you make others see."
So how do artists help others see? As asked concurrently with the invention of photography, why draw or paint when the camera's image has detailed and accurate information that already documents reality? In response to this inquiry, the 19th century pictorialist movement approached photography itself as an expressive medium. By emphasizing the abstract and ephemeral qualities of photography, pictorialists recognized that optical reality is only a small percentage of total experience. In his 1869 text, Pictorial Effect in Photography, Henry Peach Robinson linked aesthetic value to art expression by means of techniques deliberately employed to enhance the metaphysical and philosophical responses of the viewer. The language of visual art can transcend. Did you know that was a photograph, by the way? It's a photograph. The language of visual art can transcend detailed visual accuracy by translating experience into metaphor. 19th century landscape painters, such as Thomas Cole, who made this painting that we're looking at, emphasized the terribilità, a term originally derived from the dramatic power found in the works of Michelangelo. The terribilità, or unknowable awe of nature's power, can be communicated by deliberate actions that accentuate dramatic beauty, expression, and monumentality. Abstract forms or gestural mark making can replace detailed realistic information, and in doing so, allow for a broader range of interpretation. The works of Paul Cézanne, considered by many scholars to be the father of modern art, clearly demonstrate how 20th century painters moved away from realism to a more intuitive way of thinking and working, based on the reinterpretation of visual phenomena into abstract schemas. The timelessness of metaphor and abstraction in human expression is found in many disciplines throughout human history. Consider the words of this 8th century poet, scholar, musician, scientist, and painter. The poem is called Bird and Waterfall Music. Men sleep. The cassia blossoms fall. The spring night is still in the empty mountains. When the full moon rises, it troubles the birds. From time to time, you can hear them above the sound of the flooding waterfalls.
Thank you. The most beautiful experience we can have is the mysterious, the fundamental emotion which stands at the cradle of true art and true science.
When we choose to position ourselves at the precipice of the cavernous space where water plunges hundreds of feet beneath our view, we may suddenly become aware of our place in the universe and the likely possibility that we are merely small droplets on the edge of a cliff. Physical stimuli, psychological impact, intellectual and spiritual responses merge to defy clear expression. Some of you might recognize this waterfall painting from the Gammon Room. And what I'm about to show you is the development of a series based on an interest in watercolors and the tropics previous to travel and based on study of modernist paintings. Each of these paintings is monumental in scale, using acrylic and both realistic and abstracted forms from nature. Here the waterfall becomes a blue line. Here are details from a series of paintings, a central panel, a close-up botanical view, and the abstract and ephemeral sense of the waterfall, and then the entire triptych piece in combination. Interviews from 2005 with contemporary painter Elizabeth Murray, conducted by MoMA's former senior curator of painting and sculpture, Robert Storr, began to reveal the intuitive process that Murray employed. This isn't Murray, this is mine. This is Murray.
You just have to do it until all of a sudden your arm, your head, and your heart get it together.
At a certain point, I start to see things I can't see until I've painted on it a long time.
It's the obvious connections to do things that you figure out too quickly.
I want to surprise myself more and find different ways of making relationships.
The work that felt powerful was art that was there for its own sake, where someone struggled to make a visually beautiful, powerful thing.
I wanted the painting to have substantial feeling and meaning.
I started to feel that this was the door that would take me to another way of being.
Thank you, students from Advanced Painting at Eureka College. Quotes from Elizabeth Murray, contemporary painter. In visual art courses here at Eureka College, beginners learn the fundamentals of painting, drawing, and sculpture while being guided to discover and develop their own artistic voice. This process often involves the teacher stimulating problem solving by introducing an array of visual experimentations that lead to varied solutions. As with Elizabeth Murray and many contemporary artists, the process itself is what it's about. The artistic process in my work as a painter and printmaker involves deliberate intent to study animal species and their habitats. In the art studio, both optical and sensory experiences can be organized into dynamic visual components that are intended to elicit empathy for their subjects. Producing the art is not about illustrating the visual world. It's about the much more difficult task of interpreting it and reframing it in much the way a poet does. The agenda of this artist is to highlight the urgent need for conservation and the preservation of worldwide diversity. What I'm about to show you has to do with a trip to West Africa in Abidjan, where I experienced the beautiful lagoon topography with floating vegetation and large expanses of water that were sometimes completely covered and sometimes broken up by pirogues and boats that were traveling through the waterways. Translating this experience into a painting can take a lot of different turns and develop in a lot of different ways, as you'll experience looking at the very first lagoon painting I made right after my trip, and see how various views change. Here's an aerial view, and there's a little gator at the bottom. This is a watercolor painting. Here's another watercolor painting. Some of you may recognize the influence of J.M.W. Turner. Acrylic painting on a monumental scale. From the collection of Dale Birkenholz, Turner Lagoon. As you begin to study, as did the Impressionists, the effect of light and pattern in the outdoors, you often become interested in color and pattern. Here's the reflection of the plane on the water done in an abstract format. For Dr. Whitson, the fallen goose now resides in the Department of Biological Sciences at Illinois State University. The Fallen Goose acrylic painting. This is about a 13-foot painting. Oh, the deep horizon oil spill in the Gulf. And how does that impact the life of an artist who cares about the environment? The birth of an island or the destruction of a habitat? The acrylic and watercolor painting called Away. Heron Pond. This is one of my photographs from on location. And the painting. Very large scale painting, a very beautiful large scale southern Illinois habitat. Being designated as a bird watcher, or a bird lister, or a wildlife illustrator can fall short of greater truth. This visual artist came to science and art intellectually through a form of nature deprivation, learning about animals from books, the Brookfield Zoo, and the nature dioramas at the Field Museum. The environmental movement of the second half of the 20th century had its impact on our growing knowledge of water pollution, Tigers in Decline, and the heartbreaking harpooning of whales. Chicago's Art Institute provided mentorship from great paintings, and in a child's hidden studio basement, I played at art making. Since early college, I've seen the opportunity to paint as a mechanism to filter field experiences with deliberate intent to add to the contemporary conversation about environmental conservation and social change. My bird and mammal paintings are a paradigm for all of nature and our greater responses to it. As an undergraduate student and MS student, I made paintings and prints of whales and birds influenced by Florida summers, art historic role models, and by absorbing information from Jacques Cousteau's undersea TV specials and encyclopedias of the sea. Here's the wildebeest running across the bridge. They're cave paintings, but one is loose. One is a free live animal who's emerged from the cage onto the bridge from the cave. And there I am as a young painter, and here's the finished painting called A Bridge, a 20-foot painting, acrylic, with the tape off. For students who have been painting with me, the tape off lines around the bridge and the expressionist palette. This is my first solo exhibition, and there's the bridge with the wildebeest. On the right, a red finback whale. In the left corner, a whale and bird and some prints, and I did a carpet on the floor. There were 50 pieces in this show, prints and paintings. This is one of the paintings called A Finback Whale. And the finback has been painted with iridescent pearlized paint, little tiny impressionist, pointless, Seurat-like dabs and dashes of color in the front's a sculpture of a spy-happing gray whale. Here's the studio with the support column in the way, had to paint around it. I said to Dr. Cavalier, I painted a 30-foot finback whale, and he said, how'd you get it into your studio? There it is in the show. This painting is called If We Could Join, We Would. And for those of you who know me, even a little, I'm still trying to get those two sides to join. There's the dynamic, aggressive predator and the calm, gentle whale symbol that's peaceful, quiet, generous, spirit-loving. If we could join, we would. It's from the show, 1976, Etching on Copper. Brooklyn Museum Studio, still painting whales. This is a mixed media piece. It has collage elements. My mother made me this outfit. They're kind of farmer clothes, but I'm in Brooklyn. See some lines, expressive, gestural marks. This is an installation based on John Wesley Powell's expedition of the Colorado River region from 1869. He and his wife sent and relatives sent back artifacts, some birds that were in very poor condition, as well as a bear, and I think there was a cougar, various animals, and I made an installation piece. I drew the Grand Canyon of the Colorado on canvas all the way around the gallery. This is just one view. having studied works by William Henry Holmes and the photography from this time, from the 1860s and 70s. After college, my interest in science continued to be fueled by visits to our own tropics, the Florida Everglades, and over the last several years by numerous trips to study tropical rainforest habitats, including regions in Africa, the Amazon, Brazil, and the Galapagos Islands. These studies resulted in deepening my understanding of the value and urgency for preserving biodiversity. Took a lot of gator photos, made a lot of gator art. The idea here is that the alligator is a very important part of the living ecosystem, but not often loved by many. So he's paired with the vulnerable boy, positioned above, and they're equal, they're doubles, they're partners in life, both sweet, important, living creatures. The technique is acrylic glazing, like I'm teaching in painting. There's gator deer. There's a Jerinook, a deer in Africa that stands on its hind legs to eat. It really is. This is part gator, part deer. There's a pangolin. There's the remorse of the leopard and the deer. The conservation organization, Defenders of Wildlife, tells us that a few decades ago, only 20 Florida panthers remained. Through preservation efforts, the population is now estimated at between 100 and 160 individuals. But these few animals compete with local landowners and space for prey. People and predators struggle to coexist, as observed in common attitudes about having wolves, foxes, and bears as neighbors. Florida panther. I might pause here to point out the nature of the abstraction of the animal, because the idea, again, isn't to illustrate the animal, or one specific creature, or one specific moment in time, but the totality of its presence on Earth and the peril that the animal is in with devastation to its habitat. So we have a hurricane going on. This is a large painting with a great big sweeping gestural, just like in figure drawing this morning, gestural mark. Some species, such as the endangered whooping crane, as seen in the background here, exist in small numbers that are in peril of extinction should a natural disaster occur. We read in the January 11th Dallas Morning News that the state's devastating drought has made food and water scarce, raising worries among scientists that the parched conditions could threaten the only remaining flock of wild cranes. We're looking at whooping cranes. The crane vanishing as he ascends. What do you think an artist is? Says Pablo Picasso. He is a political being, constantly aware of the heartbreaking, passionate, or delightful things that happen in the world, shaping himself completely in their image. Painting is not done to decorate apartments. It's an instrument of war. Albatross mating dance. Albatrosses in love. painting. Albatross on the nest. Albatrosses in trio. You know who this is. There's the painting. It's a detail of the head. A holy figure. He has the aura. It's a little halo. In my process, establishing a line of inquiry for the development of a painting begins with the science, then the art. For 11 years, I visited the Aransas Wildlife Refuge in Texas, where about half of the remaining wild whooping cranes winter. A 2001 visit to several of the Galapagos Islands helped me understand how species differed on different islands based on gradual adaptation to available food sources and unique habitats. My paintings, prints, and photographs illustrate stages of my interest in the diversity of life and are based both on nature study and on direct observations in the field. Travels and research resulted in deepening my understanding and of the value and the urgency for preserving biodiversity. In his book, The Creation, several of you have read this if you've had classes with Dr. Mullen or myself. The Creation by E.O. Wilson. Wilson tells us that the 50 most biologically rich species hotspots that cover only 2.3% of the Earth's surface and are the exclusive homes of 42% of the planet's vertebrate species can be saved with an investment of a relatively small amount of money. This artist is compelled to ask, why aren't we doing this? If it's only 2.3% of the whole planet, and it has the most biologically diverse, rich habitat, and it isn't really going to cost that much to save it, is there a reason not to? Does that make any sense to anyone? Ibises. Trinidad. In her May 29, 2007 news article, reporter Ciola Belix implores us to recognize the slow death of Trinidad's Caroni Swamp. When comparing this wetland, both in 1998 and 2008, Dale and I were both able to observe measurable environmental degradation. We went to the same location 10 years apart. The Caroni Swamp is the largest area of mangrove in Trinidad and Tobago at approximately 40 square miles, home to an extensive variety of wildlife, silky anteater, capybara, tree boa, spectacled caiman, fiddler crab, more than 180 species of birds, blue heron, snowy egrets, and of course, the scarlet ibis. Why isn't more being done to protect it? In an area that is unique to the entire Caribbean and an internationally recognized sanctuary and nesting area for the scarlet ibis, considerable effort must be made to preserve and protect such a delicate ecosystem before it's gone. That was Tobago. Let me go back to that for a second. Maybe not. There we go. This is not an excellent slide because it's taken from a great distance, from a canoe, very far away, where scarlet ibises and other egrets and birds are coming in from Venezuela to feed at this location. And you can see them in the hundreds and hundreds, including scarlet ibises. This is the motivation and the stress on the Caroni Swamp for this painting, a very large-scale painting of ibises. I would like to acknowledge and remind you of the influence of painters such as Henri Matisse, the flatness of the space, and point out the left and right gatekeepers to this paradise that are located in the student development office currently. Show you the studio view so you can see the size of the painting to the left and get a sense of the scale. Here are the pieces that are here on campus. They're the left and the right gatekeepers guarding paradise in Trinidad and Tobago. They're pictured in an exhibit and the paintings that are derived from these. We were talking about the development of a painting, seeing a location and being motivated to make a picture about it. This is a very happy painting of a painted bunting that magically, forgive me, Dale, for that word, that unexpectedly arrived in Normal, Illinois on a west wind, should not have been there in migration, and it was a fabulous, beautiful arrival of a beautiful bird. The painting is about that beautiful bird. What else can you make based on your interest? Traveling to a place, seeing a toucan for the first time, studying the structure, the construction of real nature, and making a painting based on that learning. It's not copying the photo, it's learning from the experience, it's feeling for the animal, it's making a statement based on what you learned. In the Galapagos, I saw the magnificent frigate bird. He became a character in my paintings as well as hummingbirds. The skua and the incoming frigate bird became an abstract incoming shape and form. A moon mask. A large stealth bomber coming in to the fly zone. An abstracted, flat, modernist grid with a stealth bomber print. Realistic fish eagles. Red-tailed hawk watercolor. The barn owl arriving to a scene, proclaiming its beautiful life. Travel to see it and find it and learn about it. A lifetime of focused travel and study offers the learner firsthand experience that is supported by the scientific evidence that birds, wildlife, and habitats critical to their survival are in serious decline. When chapter leaders and concerned citizens gain access to National Audubon's reports on the status of birds, the data clearly supports this conclusion. And I quote from National Audubon's Common Birds in Decline, quote, Audubon's unprecedented analysis of 40 years of bird population data from Christmas bird count and breeding bird surveys reveals alarming declines for many of our most common and beloved birds. Since 1967, the average population for the common birds in steepest decline has fallen 68%, from 17.6 million to 5.35 million. Some species have nosedived as much as 80%, and all 20 birds included in the Common Birds in Decline report have lost at least 50% of their population in just 4 decades. Is that not a reason to be political? As an artist scientist, I assume the responsibility of learning more about how the visual arts can bridge disciplines and explore ways to expand understanding and to influence change. Curiosity leads to discovery and a life of productive meaning. There's the life flight bird, the chopper that you heard earlier. And will it escape the blades? Is it free? Is the chopper delivering those life-giving organs? Oil painting. See the wing of the plane, undersea creatures. Yes, pieces of aircraft, bits of whale, bits of bird. This is a 13-foot painting, an oil painting. It started to be a finback whale, and it morphed into a B-16 aircraft. Whale paintings. These are the beautiful creatures, the beautiful, delicate warbler, endangered habitats, which leads us to the ivory-billed woodpecker. Here are the study skins. I observed the pale-billed woodpecker in Belize. This is where I got the ideas from watching woodpeckers, drawing from the study skins and traveling, and the display that's out in the lobby will show you the steps used to make a print and make my recent work. In closing, I'd like to encourage you to study and continue to pursue your interests as students and learners, lifelong learners in the Eureka College community, and to take a stand on issues related to conservation, the preservation of biodiversity, and continuing to develop your own voice and your own vehicle and means of expression.
So it seems to me that the field experience piece that becomes the art however many months or years later, that there's obviously a serious transformation during that time. Do you have to forget parts of the field experience to get to the art, or do you have to add to what you know with your field experience?
I think the field experience accumulates over a number of years. And not just one experience, but many that are similar. I mean, there are many similarities to just taking a walk in the woods, Parklands Foundation here outside of Bloomington Normal or Lake Eureka, and then the Everglades, traveling through Florida or going to Belize or Trinidad and Tobago and those natural rainforest habitats. Those experiences all become a part of you. So in the studio, it's not just one. They converge to be about the same thing. And the same thing is really the unity of everything. It's the connectedness. We talk a lot about interconnectedness. But that's it. It's all there, and it's all there at once. And the color, like in Trinidad, the color of the scarlet ibis is incredible against that dark green. It's phenomenal to see it. It's a sensory experience. It might take years to make that painting. It's not a copy of one thing. Good question. Other questions? Yes. You know, that's a really excellent point, because we have a beautiful campus. We're near Lake Eureka. We're near a lot of other natural habitats, and even just people's backyards. And I think it has a lot to do with what we think of as being kind of tuned in to our spiritual side, that we're getting outside of a routine. We're stepping outside of, away from the computer, away from the cell phone and the interruptions and the stresses of everyday life, and we're taking ourselves to a natural place, no matter where it is. And we start to become more aware. We get quiet, we stop listening to other voices, and we start to absorb what's really there. It's like yoga. You know, that's such an excellent point. We're stepping outside of ourselves, and you have to shut out those other voices. And then you start to observe things. Just think of childhood. Think of that little ant walking across the sidewalk. Or did you as a child see a grasshopper? Did you see something? And still now, what about a butterfly? You know, it's really around us, and I think it has to do with opening up and paying attention to what's there. Yeah. Other questions? What a great question. I think we have to take a role as parents and family members to bring children into those worlds. We can't rely on a school system to do it. We have to speak out and start to move children out into the world and get with them, take them places, take them to museums and galleries, take them to concerts, take them out for walks, you know, take them to the pet store and the zoo and whatnot. But we have to take a very proactive role in doing it. And then maybe you can even decide, wait a minute, there isn't an art program in the elementary school where my child goes, or my niece goes, or my little sister or brother goes. What's with that? I mean, how hard is it to come up with the money to fund an art program? You know, I can tell you that it's possible from years of being here to do it on a shoestring. No. You could take a little money that you didn't use for something else, for a pair of boots or a sweater or something, and buy some materials for a school. Or those of you who are students who have already experienced learning, you teach somebody else what you know. Do a project after school. We talk a lot about leadership at Eureka College. You know, setting up an after-school program and introducing activities for people that don't have anything to do, and stimulating ways to learn. Great question. Others out there want to know anything? No, I don't, but I will refer you to The Creation by E.O. Wilson. And it's right at the end of the book. It's in, I think it's in the last chapter, and he speculates on the amount of money that it might take, unless my fact checkers in the audience can speak to that. So. You know, I can tell you why I started with whales. There were two things that happened to me that started me with whales. Believe it or not, one was Jonah and the whale story. As a child, I was a Bible scholar, and I was fascinated with the idea of a human being being devoured by a whale. And I started to make art about it. I made a Jonah, I made a whale, put the body in the Jonah. I wrote a little play about it. I wrote some songs about it, just in a child way. And then I was in Florida, at SeaWorld. And at SeaWorld, I was chosen. I was selected as a teenager from the audience and brought into relationship with the killer whale. And at that time, when they didn't have quite as many worries about safety, that whale breached right at SeaWorld, breached in the air, and came right down against my cheek. And I had a trainer holding my arms back, and I leaned like this. The whale came right down, and I felt that it was a mammal. I felt the warm fur, the hair-like fur. It wasn't a cold, rubbery thing, and that was a very significant experience in my life. Started to paint whales. Then I had an interim career with the Department of Corrections, which was very much deprived of nature for 8 to 10 years. Coming back, I was taken on an Audubon field trip. And the Audubon field trip was to Jasper, Pulaski, and it was to see cranes, sandhill cranes. That was my first experience with cranes. It was 1993. And I started to pay attention to birds. The Audubon Society was filled with people that were kind, loving, intelligent, wonderful, warm people to be around. Also intellectual, interesting. They taught me how to use binoculars, and I started to go out and look at birds. And it was that community that started intense interest in the birds. Previous to that, I did make a lot of birds as well, but you know, I was attracted to them because the shape of the fluke or the tail of the whale was the same shape as the wing spread, and I built that my first exhibition on that premise. And it was called, is actually called The Fluke is the Bird's Wing. So it was back there also, but developed through Audubon field trips and contact with people who study birds. Oh my goodness. What a question. I would like to see some of the birds of paradise that have these the incredible, beautiful plumage, like the and bowerbirds and birds that do spectacular mating dances and have incredible plumage, and I'd like to be hiding in a little behind a little bush or something watching that happen. Other questions?
Well, why don't we continue the conversation out in the lobby for some refreshments after in just a minute here, but please thank Professor Edgian.
Thank you. The display outside has a lot of more recent work. There's some monoprints, and I've shown you the progression of studying the ivory-billed woodpeckers and making the wood block and then the print. down the line if you want to watch down the line. I also have a lot of birding checklists that you could see, checking off those birds that have been seen. Thank you. Thanks a lot for coming. Bye.